Well, good morning on this Communion Sunday. We're looking forward to worshipping with the Lord, and I trust that you've had a wonderful week. We've heard some great reports about the youth camp that happened last week, and Chris and Monica and Malalia took the youth and went to someplace with the youth. I couldn't quite catch it. And so they've had a great time. And so if you get a chance, talk to them and see what happened throughout the week. And I should have been a bit more prepared and got them to do a testimony, shouldn't I? Well, we look like we're missing a few this morning. May have slept in, missed changing the clocks over, I guess. So let's open in a word of prayer, hey, and maybe they'll turn up. Dear Heavenly Father, we are just grateful to be in your house. We come this morning remembering you, our communion service this morning, and a reminder of all that you've done for us. We thank you for that small, short video that just reminded us of that too, Lord. And today we come, we're going to sing some hymns and some wonderful old songs reminding us of you. So, Father, we just love you, we want to worship you, and we give you all praise. Amen. Would you stand with me this morning as we sing "There is Power in the Blood"? Please stand. This month is "Faith as Small as a Mustard Seed." This is a new one for all of us, because I don't know it either. So let's sing and watch the video this morning.
Small as a
next week we'll have Hannah up here and she can do the actions for me and help me with that, hey? We'll have to learn that this week. Okay. And our next song this morning is How Great Thou Art, perhaps my favourite hymn. Changed our lives. We stand here today because we have a relationship with you. We see what you've done in our hearts and our and even in our walk, Father. I pray today that you'll continue to challenge us to be more and more like you, that you'll continue to challenge us in our walk, and a reminder of how great you are. We think of even looking at the weather at today, we just see the beauty and the creation that you've given us. How great thou art. Amen. Please take your seats this morning. Just a few announcements today. Don't forget we have the food closet and the community closet. We've been talking to different organisations throughout the weeks previously, and a lot of the churches are talking about how much this is needed in different communities, and we're finding that, you know, here in Coffs there's such a need for this type of ministry, and there'll be more to come in information about what's happening with that as well. We do have enough clothing at the moment, so that, and our food closet is fine for the moment as well, so we're not needing any donations for that at the moment. Oh, the Wesleyan Methodist Church is having its New South Wales District conference, the annual conference that starts next weekend. So Cameron and I will be away for that. We're heading off to Maitland. I always get them confused. So we're heading off to Maitland for that for a few days, and then Cameron and I are heading up to Brisbane for a week and going to a wedding, which will be really lovely. So we will be away for the next couple of weeks, but the next two Sundays. So we have Chris preaching, I think. Yep, on both of those weeks for us. He didn't say no, so I guess that is the answer. Little Footprints Cray Group will be on holidays now, next week, and the following week until we're back. And Crafty Fingers will not be on this week, but we'll start back again straight after that. Pam will be back on track for that. Next slide, please. Okay, don't forget to come and join us for morning tea straight after the service, and we welcome any visitors amongst us this morning. It's nice to see your face, and come and have a cuppa or some yummy stuff with us today. The next thing we're going to do is our offering. We're going to take up our tithes and offerings. Connell, can I get you to come and pray? Oh, yep. Thank you for our offering. And the song we'll be doing throughout that is Abide With Me. It is a relatively new one. We have sung it before, but please feel free to stand. And Connell, can I get you to pray?
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for bringing us today to your home of worship. Father, we know that everything we have comes from you. With this session of offering, Lord, I ask that you will bless our offering given, give us due diligence with our meager offering, that it will truly come from the heart. And there's no amount that we will give will ever come close to balancing the scale of your love, mercy and blessings pour down like rain upon us. Thank you, Lord, for being with us, being in our midst. Again, bless our offerings, that it will be used to always bring you the honor, the glory, in Jesus' name, amen.
I have a home, eternal home, but for now, I walk this broken world. You walked it first, you know our pain, but you show hope can rise again up from the grave. Abide with me, abide with me. Don't let me fall, and don't let go. Abide with me, don't let weep no more and sing for joy. Abide with me. Weep no more, sing for joy. Abide with me.
Amazing grace.
See?
is mine. How awesome is that to be able to claim and to have that assurance within us?
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of His Spirit, washed in His blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior. This is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Love is submission, perfect delight. Visions of rapture now burst on my sight. Angels descending, bring from above echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I in my Savior am happy and blessed. Watching and waiting, looking above, filled with His goodness, lost in His love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior. This is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long.
So that communion intro tells us exactly what communion is all about. God sent His Son, Jesus, to become flesh on this earth so that we could see God in person. But that was just one of the reasons. Then Jesus lived His life out, had his ministry with the disciples, and in that process showed us how to live our lives, the things that we need to do as being a part of God's family. But the ultimate purpose was that he became the perfect sacrifice. So it all happened on that Jewish Passover where they were supposed to sacrifice a lamb, and a perfect, unblemished lamb on the altar for the Jewish people, and so that this whole nation of Israel, so their sins could be washed away. But that is something they had to repeat over and over and over again. So when God sent his son to be that perfect lamb, so that his body was broken and his blood was shed, was so that it could have been done once and for all. For when he died on the cross and died, he took all the sin with him and left it in death, and rose again and was resurrected to a new life, which we are resurrected to. And today we're remembering what Jesus did for us. How he became God in the flesh. Then that flesh was broken and beaten and whipped and spat upon and thorns shoved into and hair ripped out of. All so that we could become a part of God's family through the name of Jesus. So as you take the bread this morning, remember what Jesus has done just for you. All that pain, all that suffering was just for you. Take the bread. And just as that unblemished lamb's blood was spilt on the altar and flowed freely, washing the altar, so did Jesus' blood flow freely for you. But his blood is different. It washes you white as snow. So as you take the cup, remember what Jesus did for you so that you could be a part of God's family. Lord, we just thank you and praise you that you are a part of our lives, and that, Lord, that you sent your son for us. And in doing that, Lord Jesus, you allowed us to become a part of your family without having to do anything on our own. No need to continually sacrifice different things for different sins and all those things you said in the Old Testament. And you brought along a new life, a new beginning, a new kingdom through Jesus Christ. And through him, we can have life eternal by claiming his name and allowing his blood to wash us white as snow. And Lord, we know it doesn't stop there. Lord, we know that being a part of your family is a continual process. A continual journey, a continual relationship where we talk with you and read your word, worship you in our day-to-day life. And I thank you for that. And Lord, there are many things happening in our church life, and I would like to pray for some of those things and the people within it. Lord, I just think of our district conference that is coming up, and I just ask, Lord, that you will just keep everyone safe as they travel to Maitland for this, Lord Jesus. We pray that, Lord, that you will just be such a powerful presence at that conference. So not only when we worship together, as we listen to speakers, but as we vote for people into positions and for things to be happened for motions to be sent to the national conference and all those sort of things, Lord, I pray that you're already talking to the hearts of the people who are voting, and that they vote unified in Christ. Lord, I just thank you for Glennis and John, and I just ask you continue to uplift them and encourage them as they continue on in their journey and of the medical health problems that they have. I pray, Lord, that even when things don't seem great, they still have a smile on their face because they know the greatest of all, you, are with them in all that is happening in their lives. We also think of their grandson, Tamana, and we pray for his health and for his uplifting and also for his parents, Lord, that you will just guide them and help them. May they have opportunities to come and just praise and worship with you. Lord, we just ask for your blessings upon them. We also think of Gwen, and we just ask you to be with her and continue to encourage her and, Lord, in her life that she has with you. After seeing all those years of 96 years of being alive, Lord, and all the changes in the world, she knows one thing that doesn't change, and that's you. And Lord, I pray, I'm just so blessed to talk to her about her life as she learnt about you and has lived that life with you and continues to do so. I pray, Lord, that she will continue to tell her story to those around her. Just love her with amazing blessings today, Lord. We think of Sheila and we can truly ask for your hand upon her. May you just encourage her and uplift her. Lord, just help her with her health and all that is happening with her heart and those things, Lord, that are causing her some physical grief at the moment. And we pray, Lord, that she too continues just to lean upon you and trust in you in what is happening in her life. We thank you for Jan, and she continues to watch us online, Lord, and we just thank you for her commitment to our church family. And even though she's not present, but she is present by watching online each week, Lord Jesus. And so we just ask for your blessings upon her. May her week be one of just utmost joy, one where she just feels your presence and knows that you have gone before her, Lord Jesus. Lord, we want to thank you for the Cheney Manual Church that meets here, that comes in the afternoon and has their church service plus all the groups that meet during the week. And we just thank you for this wonderful group of people who believe in Jesus. Lord, they are such a generous group who are loving and caring and just are so grateful for a facility like this that can house all of them and allow them to be able to have their groups and run their meetings and do all the things they love doing together as a part of your family. I pray, Lord, that they'll have an amazing Sunday this week as they have special guests who have come from Perth, and all these ladies have come for a special time together as women. And we pray that while they're here, Lord, that you will just bless them and encourage them and uplift them, and that they'll go back to Perth just feeling reinvigorated and just re-infused with your love and grace and mercy so that they can affect their community. Not only other people from the Chin State, but people that they live around them. And Lord, I just want to thank you for their graciousness in wanting to help us in all that we do. I just thank you that they are willing to do gardens and fix things and mend stuff as needed, and are just so willing to do that. And I just thank you for them, Lord Jesus, and all that they bring to us as a church family. Lord, just be with those who are on holidays, especially during the school holidays. May you continue to guide and protect people, keep them safe on the roads. But also, Lord, that as they all head back next week to their homes, I pray that they are refreshed and relaxed. But Lord, also that there's opportunities for them to witness your glory through nature and through conversations with people who know you. Be with us as we continue to praise and worship you this morning, as we hear your word and as we hear the message today in your glorious and wonderful name. Amen. Our scripture reading this morning. So if you have your Bible or you use an app, please turn to Genesis 22, verses 1 to 12. That's also where our sermon will be sitting today as we go to the last not the last, to the next one in our faith series. This is week three. But this is the scripture for that this morning. Sometime later, God tested Abraham's faith. "Abraham," God called. "Yes," he replied, "here I am. Take your son, your only son, yes, Isaac, whom you love so much, and go to the land of Moriah. Go and sacrifice him as a burnt offering on one of the mountains which I will show you." The next morning, Abraham got up early. He saddled his donkey and took two of his servants with him, along with his son Isaac. Then he chopped wood for a fire for a burnt offering and set out for the place God had told him about. On the third day of their journey, Abraham looked up and saw the place in a distance. "Stay here with the donkey," Abraham told the servants. "The boy and I will travel a little farther. We will worship here, then we'll come right back." So Abraham placed the wood for the burnt offering on Isaac's shoulder, while he himself carried the fire and the knife. As the two of them walked on together, Isaac turned to Abraham and said, "Father." "Yes, my son," Abraham replied. "We have the fire and the wood," the boy said, "but where is the sheep for the burnt offering?" "God will provide a sheep for the burnt offering, my son," Abraham answered, and they both walked on together. When they arrived at the place where God had told him to go, Abraham built an altar and arranged the wood on top. Then he tied his son Isaac and laid him on the altar on top of the wood. And Abraham picked up the knife to kill his son as a sacrifice. At that moment, the angel of the Lord came to him from heaven. "Abraham, Abraham." "Yes," Abraham replied, "here I am." "Don't lay a hand on that boy," the angel said. "Do not hurt him in any way, for now I know that you truly fear God. You have not withheld from me even your son, your only son." Lord, we just thank you for the opportunity to look at your word and to see what it has for us today. And Lord, as we come before you, may your grace and your mercy just be so obvious to us. And as we hear your word explained today, may our hearts and our minds and our eyes be open to you, so that, Lord, that we know what it is we need to learn from this today. In your glorious and wonderful name, amen. So this is our third week. We've been doing faith for the last couple of weeks. A faith-filled life is a fulfilling life is sort of the overall look at these sermons. And so out of that, the question is, what does a faith-filled life look like? Well, God tells Abraham to go. Living a faith-filled life is about willingness to step out of comfort so you can step into a life of purpose. That was our first week. In the second week, God tells Abraham he will have a son. Abraham rushes the process. So living a faithful life is about a willingness to trust that God's timing is always the best timing. Abraham finally has a son when he's 100 years old. Our scripture reading today is where we're looking at this coming week. And here we have Abraham following God's commands. He's been told to grab his son, to go on a journey to this particular place, to this mountain, and to give up the very thing he has wanted his whole life, a son, an heir. To sacrifice him. And Abraham, who is full of faith, follows God's command, takes his son, goes up to the mountain, builds the altar, lays the wood, places his son on the altar, And God stops him and says, no, you are, listen to me, you are filled with your faith, and I know that you will not let anything be a part of your life that I haven't asked for. And when you look at this moment in Abraham's life, I don't think you can ever fully appreciate what is happening right at this moment in this particular story of Abraham's life. So let's just have a little look at behind the scenes. So there's some context you need to look at when looking at this particular story in Abraham's life. Abraham is now an old man, so he was 100 when his son was born. And Isaac is a young man, probably between 18 and 20. And so how do we come to that conclusion? Well, Abraham stacks all the wood onto Isaac. So do you think a boy that is 12, 14 or younger can do that? No, he has to be fairly well built, strong, because it's not a small amount of wood. And he easily takes it to where they're climbing to. So with all the context and all that sort of thing, all the people who have more vast knowledge than me think he's about 18 to 20. He is Isaac's only true heir. This also isn't Isaac's first experience with God. Abraham didn't think Isaac would die. I don't know if you noticed, but in verse 5, he looks at his servants and he says, stay here with the donkey, Abraham told the servants. The boy and I will travel a little farther. We will worship there. Then we will come back. Abraham knew God wouldn't sacrifice Isaac just through the words he uses. And this is a prophetic reenactment. So just think about what's happening here. Think about when Jesus came to earth, you know, and just see how the two come together. So when you look at this story at first glance, when you just read it, you don't really delve into it, and you just sort of look at the service thing, it really makes you question about God a little bit. Why would God tell someone who loves God, who listens to God, put him through an ordeal of sacrificing his son? And if you begin to really feel for Abraham, if you have your own child or have someone who's been really close, a niece or a nephew, then you would understand his feelings and feel sorry for Isaac as you're just imagining Abraham taking his son to sacrifice him on the altar. But I want us to look deeper, look into this story. I want us to try and see behind the scenes to what this is really all about. This story is about a father's willingness to sacrifice his son. And it's about a son's willingness to be sacrificed by his father. Because he didn't struggle, he didn't fight Abraham when he got him to get up onto the altar. But it's not about Abraham, it's not about Isaac. It is about God the Father and Jesus the Son. John 3:16 is a verse you well know. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. And Luke 22:42, Father, if you are willing, please take this cup of suffering away from me. Yet I want your will to be done, not mine. You see, this is the gospel. This is the whole reason we get together every Sunday. It's everything. Without this, there is nothing. Without what God did in sending his son, we should just pack up and go home. But that is the very reason we're all here today, that we all claim the name of Jesus, that we're all part of this family of God. We've been talking about what it looks like to live a faith-filled life. But the truth is, there is no need for faith at all. So at the end of the day, to wrap up this series, this is what I'm looking at. Living a faith-filled life is simply about a willingness to believe. But to believe what? What do we have to believe? What is the foundation of this faith, of this belief that we carry every moment of the day? Well, the first thing is that we know that we are sinners. Romans 3:23, for every one has sinned, we all fall short of God's glorious standard. We have God who created all things, made man and woman, gave them all the free will and opportunity. That included not only listening to his voice, but listening to someone who didn't think God was right. And in that process of their free will, free will and choices, sin came to this world, which separated us in such a way from God. And he tried lots of different things to bridge that separation, to get people closer to him. But like we are as humans, we listen and then forget, and listen and forget, and listen and forget. And so God had to come up with something better. So he sends Jesus. And when he sends Jesus, it radically changes the whole story. Because there was before Jesus, and everything man was trying to do to please God, to become a part of his family. Jesus turns up and radically changes everything that follows his death and resurrection. We need to believe that Jesus is our Savior, that it is only him can take our sins away, to wash us clean. John 14:6, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one can come to the Father except through me. Mark 16:16, anyone who believes and is baptized will be saved, but anyone who refuses to believe will be condemned. If we don't believe who Jesus is, if we don't believe he is God's Son, if we don't believe he was real, that he died on that cross and rose again, if we don't believe that, then we'll never be a part of God's family. God will keep trying. He'll keep reminding us about who God is through conversations, through things in our life, through people who truly believe that Jesus is the Son of God. And he will keep doing that to the very last breath that you have, giving you every opportunity to claim Jesus' name. He doesn't give up. He sent his son for that particular purpose, and he wants everyone to know who Jesus is. And in previous sermons, we've talked about that's our role. is to help people to discover God and who Jesus is, and how that should be a part of their life. Our job is not to get them to change their mind and to become Christians. Our job is to let them know about God and Jesus and all that it means, the gospel story, and how that fitted into our lives. We were like this. Jesus came, a big but, and then we are now like this. Of course, we stumble, we fall, but because we trust in God and trust in His Son, we get helped by Jesus to stand back up and continue in our journey of faith. Faith in Jesus is what brings you back into a right relationship with God. When things are falling around you, when trouble seems to come knocking, and sometimes it's just not a gentle knock, sometimes it feels like a bus or a truck runs you over, Jesus is there to pick you up, mend your wounds, to get you focused back upon Him, to reignite the faith that's just a flickering light. And faith is all about believing that Jesus is the Son of God, believing that no matter what, He'll always be there. Hebrews 11:1 says, faith shows us the reality of what we hope for. It is the evidence of things we cannot see. I know most of you and talk with you regularly, and I know where you guys are, but sometimes what you show when I talk to you and what happens in your real life is not necessarily the same thing. So wherever you are today, the belief in God that He sent His Son to be sacrificed, and a Son that was willing to be sacrificed, you need to be reminded that it is this very sacrifice that saved you from your sin. At whatever point in your life that you discovered who Jesus was and what it meant, and you just were total radical change of mind and heart happened, because that's what happens when you meet with Jesus. It's just not a simple, it's a radical change. Even if it doesn't seem like it, it is. And it reminds you that this sacrifice happened so that you could be saved from your sin and be made right with God. And there are some of you who may be online looking today. You may have friends and family who need to decide to believe for that first time, to truly go, yes, Jesus died for me and rose again so that my sins could be taken in His death and left there, and that His blood just washes me clean. And that it takes you, who's almost there, just that little bit more of a belief, a little bit more of a faith, to go yes. And that's where those who already said yes to Jesus can step in and put your arm around them, put your hand on their shoulder, and just lift them to God. To imbue them with your encouragement and the faith and strength that you have that comes from your belief in Jesus. So, my family of God, those who are sitting in front of me today, those who are online watching, if you've taken that step, have that faith, then who can you share that belief with? Who can you guide? Who can you help point to God and say, here, open the Bible and say, this is what Jesus did. He came, became flesh, and we celebrate Christmas time for that. And then he grows up and becomes a young man and steps into his full ministry God has called him to, and gathers his disciples together and teaches them and shows them and shows us that life, and then does the ultimate thing God has called him to and take that sacrifice. Are there people you can share that with or open them to what God has done them, has done for them? Our faith is not only stepping out of a comfort into a purpose. Not only is it allowing God's timing and trusting it to happen, but it's also that willingness to continually believe every moment of the day. No matter what happens, no matter how big the truck is that runs us over. And then allowing that faith-filled life to be shown to others. Let's pray. Dear Lord and Heavenly Father, we just thank you and praise you that you sent your son Jesus. And as we read that story about Isaac and his willingness to give up his son for you, Lord, we know this is just a precursor to the story, the gospel story, where you give up your son for us, who willingly sacrifices himself so that we could have life eternal with you and to be seen as being right in your eyes. I am ever so grateful for my own life and for finding out who you were and then finding out who your son is and then discovering about the Holy Spirit who is here with us all the time, helping us, encouraging us, guiding us in the things that we do. So Lord, as we live our faith-filled life out, may we step into the purpose you have called us for. May we trust your timing. And may we continue to have such willingness to believe in you. Guide us this week. Help us this week to share that faithful life with others so that they too can discover you and discover who Jesus is and what he did and how the Holy Spirit can be a part of their lives. We thank you, Lord, and we praise you in your glorious and wonderful life. Amen. Please stand with me as we sing probably an obvious hymn, well, it was for me, an obvious hymn to this sermon, Because He Lives. Please stand. So as you go this week and live your faithful life, I just want to leave you a quote with Martin Luther. Faith is living, is a living, daring confidence in God's grace. So sure and certain that a man could stake his life on it 1,000 times. And if you're not sure where that sits, then just think of those who live in countries around the world who do stake their lives on it every time they say the name of Jesus. There are countries where his name means death, life imprisonment. And it's hard for us to understand, but that still needs to be the same faith that you are living. This living, daring confidence. That belief that Jesus is God's Son. We'll see you all at morning tea downstairs. Have a great week and enjoy.
Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. Lord, turn.